Wow. Mike's quite right. I thought, gosh, you know, when you're experiencing the presence of God like that, how far can words ever get you? And yet he gives us his word. And he gives us his word to help us find context and meaning for the encounters that we have with him. And I want to talk tonight about how we can make God at home in our lives. And God's presence is everywhere. We know that. It's his omnipresence, the fact that he exists in the whole of creation. But also God manifests his presence at particular times and in particular places. And it's a little like how oxygen is everywhere in this room, and yet it would be possible for us to compress oxygen into a cylinder and to concentrate it in a particular place. And so from the burning bush when Moses meets God to the day of Pentecost when the fire of heaven falls, that God manifests his presence. And so when I talk about how making God at home, that's really what I've got at the back of my mind. That's what we're thinking about. How is it that we, as we learn to live naturally supernatural lives, can do everything that we can to make God at home in our lives personally, but also in the communities that we come from, the churches that we're a part of, how can we make God at home? And in order to answer that question, I want to look at a passage that you can find. If you have a Bible with you, you can find it in 2 Chronicles chapter 5. But this is where people very literally make God at home. And one of the reasons I want to talk about this is because it's we, to varying degrees, are good or not good at making people feel at home in our own homes, just on a personal level. So I am not what you might call a natural host of people. I am an introvert, like times 10. And I, if you were to give me notice, if you were to come to my house and you were to give me 2 to 3 weeks notice that you were coming around on a particular evening, I think I could do an all right job of making you at home, because I would have that time to psych myself up for your visit. I would spend on the day of your visit probably about 7 or 8 hours in a darkened room alone, just hoarding energy like introverts do, just replenishing my stores for the inevitable drain that I know is going to happen the moment you walk through my door. So I can do planned hospitality just about, but spontaneous hospitality, do not ask that of me, because it will not work out well for either of us. And I've had that experience on many occasions where, and if there's any other introverts in the room, you can relate to this, where you just got a nice evening planned, just you and a book or you and a film, and you're cooking a meal for one, which you're very much looking forward to eating alone in silence, and then somebody knocks on the door, and you go to the door, and it's someone, you know, you might know them, and they're like, they're expecting at that point a warm welcome from you. And for me personally, when someone interrupts me, when I've got that in my head that that's what I'm going to be doing, I'm so looking forward to that. That replenishes me. Somebody knocks on my door. Immediately, when I open the door, this internal agony starts going on inside of me, because I don't want to invite them in. I want them to leave me alone. And yet, I'm a pastor in a church, and I've been trained, and I know that it says in the Bible that we're to practice hospitality. So this battle starts, and because I know I'm meant to welcome people in and I'm meant to be like that, I try, like I really, really do try to welcome them. So I say, it's so good that you've stopped by. Would you like to come in? But I can tell by the way that people react, and I've reflected on it quite a few times now, like introverts tend to reflect on things when they're by themselves. I can tell that I'm obviously not very good at it, because immediately what happens is I say, would you like to come in? And their smile kind of falters, and they look a bit dubious, they look a little bit doubtful, and then they step in. And the moment they step in, they start apologizing for interrupting me. I'm so sorry, I won't be very long, at which point it's too far now, you know, I'm saying, no, it's fine, you're not interrupting me at all, come on in. That's how I host, and after 15 minutes of awkward small chat, eventually they clear off, and I get back to enjoying my life. others of you, that horrifies you. Everything I've just described is alien to you because you're built in a completely different way. The moment somebody knocks on your door, it's like the door is flung open, you know, and it's like a huge bear hug embrace. Come on in. I had an evening all by myself. Thank goodness you stopped by, you know. I've cooked this meal. I only cooked enough food for one, but please, you have it. I'll just sit here and watch you eat. I can't wait to do that. I was going to watch this film, but hey, let's just switch that off. Come on over. Now tell me, how are you? No, really, how are you? I just want to know everything. I'm all ears for the next 3 or 4 hours. Just tell me. And I love people like that because the moment you go into their home, you do feel very much at home. You feel like, oh, I can relax here. I can spread out. I can be myself. I can just kick back. And so there are different ways to host. And my question would be, when it comes to the presence of God, the manifest presence of God, what type of host are you? And in 2 Chronicles, chapter 5, the context of the passage is that in the wilderness, Israel built the tabernacle, this kind of tent where God would live. His presence came and dwelled there above the Ark of the Covenant, right in the center, the most holy place. And that was the case for hundreds of years until Solomon eventually built the temple. And we're going to start reading just after he's finished. But if you were to read in 2 Chronicles chapter 3 and 4, you would get something of the effort that went into making this home for God. And it is crazy. Like, I only started to look at some of this stuff in detail a little while ago. They really went to town when they were building the temple. So there's 150,000 people working on this as a building project for 7 years. And the thing that's particularly impressive about the temple is not so much its size, because it wasn't actually that big a space. There are cathedrals in this country, many of them, that would be bigger than the temple was. But it was its opulence. It was the extravagance and the wealth that they poured into making it just the most beautiful place that they could possibly create. And so they get all this, the finest wood they can find, cedar trees from Lebanon, and they get them chopped down and floated down, and they use that for the paneling in the temple. They cover it in sculptures and carvings, so they get palm trees and pomegranates and all this other stuff carved, and cherubim carved into the kind of the woodwork and stuff, and they cover that then in gold. And they created this curtain that would hang before the most holy place that was made out of fine linen and just from the best yarn. It was crimson and gold, and they would weave cherubim into that. They used bronze, so much bronze, it tells us in the scripture, that they stopped bothering to count it. It was just like, this is just a heck of a lot of bronze. And so they make like this bronze altar and these bronze pillars and this bronze chains with 100 bronze pomegranates hanging from it. They make this bronze thing called the sea, which is this giant bronze basin that sits on top of these bronze balls. And it's so big that you could fit 400 bathtubs of water into the sea. It's what the priests would use to wash. But where they really went to town, they added gold, they added precious gems, but it was the gold that was crazy. They just covered the whole thing in gold. So they had gold on the walls, and they covered all the sculptures in gold, and they made golden lampstands and another little golden altar. They covered the doors in gold. All of the doors got covered in gold. And it says here, they have golden wick trimmers. That's when you know you've got a lot of gold. If you're making golden scissors just to trim a candle, you know you've got probably a little too much gold in that temple. But they went crazy. And I was looking up, like, what's the modern equivalent of, like, value of all of the stuff that they use? And it's billions and billions of pounds. In a space that's not really that big, they pour their wealth into it. And then if that's not enough, just to finish it off, they get some rooms and they just stuff gold into it, like piles of gold and silver and all this furniture that David's been saving up for the temple. So this is a crazy house. Like, if you think you've seen some mental stuff on Grand Designs, you have no idea. When it comes to the temple of God, this is a whole nother level. And so that's just happened. 7 years of building. Verse 2, 2 Chronicles chapter 5. Then Solomon summoned to Jerusalem the elders of Israel, all the heads of the tribes, and the chiefs of the Israelite families. So anyone who is anyone gets brought to the Ark of the Covenant. And then what they do is they bring the Ark of the Covenant from Zion, the city of David, and all the Israelites came together to the king at the time of the festival in the 7th month. And so if we could just fall into the pages of the scripture right now, what we would find ourselves in is a city, Jerusalem, that is absolutely heaving with people. And there's an air of anticipation and excitement, because for the last 7 years, the temple has been under construction, and now finally it's getting dedicated. So there would have been an eagerness just on a human level, because you get to see this incredible building. But more than that, this is a national event where they're worshiping God, and they're all there. And we'd be a part of that. And then it goes on and it says, verse 4, when all the elders of Israel had arrived, the Levites took up the ark, and they brought the ark and the tent of meeting and all the sacred furnishings in it. The Levitical priests carried them up, and King Solomon and the entire assembly of Israel that had gathered about him were before the ark, sacrificing so many sheep and cattle that they could not be recorded or counted. So either Israel had some very lazy accountants back in the day, they can't count the bronze, they can't count the animals, or there's just a lot, they've just gone bananas, they're going crazy at this celebration. And then it says, verse 7, the priests then brought the ark of the Lord's covenant to its place in the inner sanctuary of the temple, the most holy place, this special room right in the middle. They put it beneath the wings of the cherubim. The cherubim spread their wings over the place of the ark and covered the ark and its carrying poles. These poles were so long that their ends extended from the ark and could be seen from in front of the inner sanctuary, but not from outside the holy place, and they are still there today. There was nothing in the ark except the two tablets that Moses had placed in it at Horeb, where the Lord made a covenant with the Israelites after they came out of Egypt. The priests then withdrew from the holy place. All the priests who were there had consecrated themselves, regardless of their divisions. And what that means is the priests would normally work in shifts. They would, you know, it would never be the case that they were all on a shift at the same time. And yet for this, they all gather together. Every single priest is there. They consecrate themselves. And it says all the Levites, who were the musicians, so the worship leaders of the day, Asaph, Heman, Jeduthun, and their sons and relatives stood on the east side of the altar dressed in fine linen, the ancient equivalent of a check shirt and skinny jeans. And it says, and they were playing harps and cymbals and harps and lyres, and they were accompanied by 120 priests sounding trumpets. So again, just imagine the noise and picture yourself there right in front of you. This is all happening. The trumpeters and musicians joined in unison, just as we have done just a moment ago, to give praise and thanks to God, accompanied by trumpets and cymbals and other instruments. The singers raised their voices in praise to the Lord and sang, "He is good, his love endures forever," which, by the by, is the most quoted phrase in the whole of the scripture. He is good, his love endures forever. Then the temple of the Lord was filled with the cloud, and the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the temple of God. And so there's just a few things for us to pick up from that as we think about how do we make God at home in our lives. The first one is understand what is precious in this picture. And it's not the gold. It's not the tens of billions of pounds worth of gold and precious gems and bronze and cedar. It's the cloud. It's the cloud of glory. And it's the preciousness of the presence of God. The presence of God is what is precious. Without that, the temple is just a big gold box. A temple without the glory of God is like a body without a heartbeat. It's just dead. It's just something material, but there's nothing there of life. There's nothing there of value. And for us, as we consider what it is to live a naturally supernatural life, it starts with understanding and placing just such a value on the manifest presence of our God. And this, for me, has been a bit of a journey. I didn't grow up in a church tradition where there was much space given over to God moving and doing things, and so I didn't realize that he did until I was about 17 or 18. And I remember being exposed to that for the first time. Actually, it's something Mike was speaking at when someone I prayed for fell over, and I thought, whoa, this is weird. But gradually over the years, I've come to see, gosh, I never want to be anywhere without this, without this space for God to move in ways that he chooses to. And I remember there was this one festival we had, Momentum, a number of years ago now, and it came home to me in a new way. And it came home to me because by that point, we've been doing festivals for a while, and I got used to, I suppose, seeing people meet the Holy Spirit, seeing young people filled with the Holy Spirit for the first time. And there's always a joy in that. But I suppose after, like, I don't know how many days of festivals, you get used to it. And then there was this one festival right at the end, Momentum, where we made space, as we always do, for God to do what he wanted to do. And we worshipped him and we proclaimed his word. But the manifest power of God wasn't there in the way that we had become used to, accustomed to. We were expecting more than did happen. And it got to the morning of the third day of momentum, and we just hadn't seen anywhere near the power of God that we were hoping to see, or the presence of God manifest himself. And so we Mike texted literally everybody in his phone book and just said, pray, please pray. And please, you know, let's just intercede. Let's ask God to meet with us. And I remember that day, it was like, a door in heaven opened or something like that. And just suddenly from nowhere, God did walk into the room. And it's not that he wasn't in the room before. You understand that. I know that. But it's just like there was something there that wasn't there before of his glory. And I remember it because as I reflected on that during a happy alone time in my life when no one interrupted me, as I reflected alone on that, I realized that if I had never come into contact with some of this stuff, I would have probably ended up in church ministry, I think, and it would have been, I'm sure, fine. And we would have worshiped Jesus and we would have preached the gospel, and you know, that's amazing. But I think it would have been incomplete if I hadn't discovered that there is a way of making God at home, that he would move among us and do things that he wouldn't otherwise. I would have filled a ministry with just human activity, and God would have used it in his kindness, but I would have missed it. And it's like, I look back now and I'm so grateful that it's like fairly early on, I've discovered something of the preciousness of the presence of God. And the presence of God is precious for many reasons. One is because that's where the joy is. You know, I know we heard from Galatians this afternoon, where's all your joy gone? The joy is found in his presence, but also that's where the power is. That's where people get changed and they get transformed. And the power of God, as we've heard already, is not this thing that God sends to us like a lightning bolt from a cloud, you know, or like an Amazon delivery that gets, you know, packaged up in some faraway warehouse and dropped off at our door. It's not this distant thing. There's a closeness and an intimacy. And so the power is in the presence of God. Think of the presence of God more like a fire than anything else. If we want to get warm, what we do is we get close. And as we're close, we're changed. And as we're close, we're healed. And as we're close, we find life. And again, seeing this so many times, one of the obvious places in times of worship, just as we've had now, where the glory of God descends in a way that he wasn't there before. And in those moments, often people tell us that you've probably experienced it one time or another where something breaks or something changes. There was a young man that came up to me at the festivals a few years ago, and his brother had been murdered when he was 7 years old. From that point, he'd always had quite an issue with anger. And he came along, he was brought along by some people, he wasn't a Christian, to the festival, and he kind of endured it for 3 or 4 days. And then on the final day, he said to God, okay, God, if you're real, show me. And he said God's presence just met him in that moment, and it felt like all the anger that he had was being ripped out of him. And he said it felt so weird because the only emotion that he'd ever known was anger. And so he said, I know like meeting God's meant to be nice, but it didn't feel nice. It just felt so strange. But he said, since that moment, I've been different. I've been changed. And all his youth group, when he was telling me this, were there with him, and they were just nodding and going, yes, he's really very, very different. He's really, really different. Celebrating the transformation that happened in his life. And it was like, it was proximity to Jesus' presence that did that. And so understand, the foundation is to understand that there's a preciousness about the manifest presence of God. I don't want to waste my life chasing tens of billions of pounds worth of gold when there's the presence of the living God that we could seek. That's the first thing. The second observation is they value the presence of God. And the way that they do that, obviously they see that it's precious. And as a response to that, they value it. And there are two things that they do in this particular passage to value the presence of God. The first one is they sacrifice. And so we just heard about that. There's Solomon and the entire assembly of Israel sacrificing herds, like countless sheep and cattle before God. And for us, as we look to how do I make God at home in my life, the first thing is sacrifice, and to understand that principle of sacrifice. Now, the first thing to get about the sacrifice thing is not that they're sacrificing in order to earn God's presence. It looks like that on the surface, because you see, I read it first time, you know, they sacrifice loads of sheep and cattle and stuff like that. And then after they've done that, the glory of God comes, the cloud fills the temple. So it looks like you do the sacrificing, and then God responds to that, and he pours out his presence, almost like as a reward for your sacrifice. But that's not what's happening, because what's there right in the middle of them is the Ark of the Covenant, the place that God dwells. So they've got the ark already. They've already got the presence of God right there in their midst. They're not sacrificing in order to earn the presence of God. They're sacrificing as a response to the fact that God is already present. So what they're doing is they're valuing his presence and they're honoring his presence. And as the church of Jesus Christ, we have the presence of God living inside of us. None of us can ever come to know God save but through the power of the Holy Spirit. So he's already dwelling in us. We cannot earn him. There's only one sacrifice that's necessary for us to receive the presence of the living God. And it happened once for all on a cross 2,000 years ago. So we don't earn his presence. But what we can do is, as a response to the fact that we, the church, have the presence, we can value that. Think about it like this. I have a little list of people, although I'm an introvert, I'm only 9 out of 10 on the scale. So I do have a list of people that I feel would refresh me were they to come over for dinner. One of those people is the rugby legend, Johnny Wilkinson. And let's say that one evening I've got a whole evening planned by myself and Johnny comes knocking on the door and I see that it's Johnny Wilkinson. Now the first thing I'm going to do when I realize it's Johnny Wilkinson is get a selfie before he leaves so I can make sure I can prove to the whole world on social media that it's happened. But the second thing I would do is I would invite Johnny in and I would say, Johnny, please come in. Please do whatever you want. And then I'd get excited. I'm like, oh my word, I've got Johnny Wilkinson in the house. So I need to get like the best stuff I've got. Let's break out Tesco's finest. Let's put on the film, whatever you want to watch, Johnny, let's just put it on, let's just do that. And what I'm doing there is, as a response to the fact that Johnny's walked into the house, I'm giving him the best I've got. Now, what I'm not doing is earning Johnny's visits. You know, if I ring Johnny up and try and promise him like steak and schlur, which is the best I do have to offer, like if I ring Johnny up and say, hey, I'm a really lively conversationalist, Johnny, come on down, that's not going to happen. Trying to get Johnny Wilkinson into my house is the hard part, but he's already in my house, so then the valuing of him is the easy part. Do you see the difference? We can't ever earn the presence of God, but what we can, that the hard part's been done for us. He's the gift to us. But what we can do is a response to the fact that he's in our hearts and lives is honor that. And all sacrifice is doing, well, one of the things it's doing is it's establishing priorities. It was one of the ways that Israel worshipped God, and they said to him, you, the creator, are more important than these, the creation. And we honor you by sacrificing them to you. And so for us, one of the ways it might look in our lives is to consider what are those things that we want to lay before him again, that we want to surrender to him. Ways of kind of prioritizing that. Lord, it's your manifest presence that is my priority as I wander through life, as I wander through my week. You know, if we were to get the countless numbers of cows in here and do an actual visual illustration, we could write on the cows different things, I imagine, different ones of us. For those of us who lead churches and who lead small groups, one of the things that we would need to sacrifice, we've already heard about it, and we'll hear about it some more, I'm sure, tomorrow, but is order and the need for everything to run in according to plan. That has to be killed if we want to be open to God's manifest presence. Another thing is neatness. You know, you're going to have to lay that down if you want God to come, because as we've heard already, it's messy sometimes. But for us personally, what are those cows that need to be surrendered to him? I've got a whole list of them. Some of my biggest cows, if I can put it like this, are, number one, my reputation. I can't kill that thing. It keeps coming. I sacrifice it. I've never actually killed a cow, but I imagine it's probably quite a tricky operation. But they keep coming back, these things. I sacrifice my reputation. And then again today, I've been wrestling through, well, what are people going to think of me if I speak? When it's like, who cares? This is about Jesus, and you stupid moron. How many times do you have to go through this? Another thing, fear of failure. The number of times I invite the Holy Spirit and I'm terrified that nothing is going to happen. Absolutely terrified, because I think that's a judgment on who I am. I have to kill that if I'm going to see more of the manifest presence of God. Another big one, I've already alluded to the fact that this is part of my personality, is I don't like being interrupted. I like having, you know, I get focused on a goal. I don't like things being interrupted. Well, that doesn't really work. Like, if you're going to be open to the manifest presence of God, not just in a church meeting, but like as you're walking through your day, for God to just suddenly speak to you and whisper to you or say, go here or do that, like, and you're not open to being interrupted, you're really going to find that hard. One of the most helpful things anyone ever said to me about hearing God speak in the everyday is they said, you know it's God if it's the wrong person at the wrong time in the wrong place. And what they were getting at is it's never convenient. It's always an interruption to what you're already doing. And those, each of those things are things that I need to surrender to him, sacrifice before him. It's a way of saying to the Lord, Lord, I'm serious about honoring your presence. You are my priority. These things, they matter to me, but I want to make it absolutely, abundantly plain to you that your glory and you're filling my life and you're using me to minister to other people matters infinitely more. So how can I surrender it to you? So they sacrifice. The second thing that they do in order to value the presence of God, and it's an obvious thing really, but they sing. They sacrifice and they sing. And we've just been singing and worshiping the Lord. And I love the fact, I mean, sacrifice and song, they kind of go together. They're both worship, and they're both worship as a response to who he is and who we see him to be. So Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, in view of God's mercy, as a response to his mercy, offer your bodies as living sacrifices. But also there are clearly in the Bible, and we've just experienced it now, moments of particular devotion where we just, what we're doing in those times is we're glorifying him absolutely and firstly, but also we're enjoying him. We're savoring him. We're just delighting in his presence. And I love the way that they do it. It's so simple. You know, it's like, this is, I mean, this is incredible theology, but it's kind of quite a straightforward thing. He is good. And his love endures forever. It never, ever, ever ends. It won't ever run out. And they just enjoy that truth about God. They sang that line 3,000 years ago. And it's as true today as we sing it now as it was back then. And in 3,000 years from now, it will be true. We can sing that now at whatever age we are, and just virtually on our deathbed, we can still sing it. And though we'll have changed in 1,000 ways, he won't have changed in a single one, because he is good and his love endures forever. And so when we talk about singing, what we mean by that is taking time to savor him and to enjoy him. Beth and I, a little while ago, we went to Rome on a holiday, and by the time we arrived at Rome, we'd already been to a few different places, and I had dragged Beth to virtually every ancient thing you can find in Italy, and there's a lot of them, so she was over it. But I managed to persuade her that we would take one last trip to, we go to the Vatican, and we went to the Vatican, we just had 3 hours to look around it, and we really just wanted to see the Sistine Chapel, not because we're into art, but because we wanted to be able to tell people that we had seen the Sistine Chapel. So we went through, you have to go through this whole maze of paintings and sculptures, and, you know, it's all this incredible stuff that they have there. And it takes ages to get to the Sistine Chapel. So we just rushed through everything to finally get to the Sistine Chapel, have a little look at it for 10 minutes and then walk out. And we went to the Vatican, a place where people spend weeks just staring at one painting, or they will take like a whole lifetime to enjoy a single corridor of art in that place. We rushed through it in 3 hours and we saw a lot of things in the Vatican, but we didn't adore a single one. Because adoration takes a while. What was the last thing you adored quickly? The way that Richard Foster puts it is he says, activity is the enemy of adoration. And for us to worship God and to savor him, it takes just time. And so where are those moments? And maybe we snatch them here and there, and that's good, but where are those times where we savor his presence, where we enjoy him? Another way of saying sacrifice and song is to say we make the manifest presence of God at home in us when we make sure that he's our priority and when we take pleasure in him. We take pleasure in him. I don't think God can resist making himself at home when someone makes him the priority and they just enjoy him. And you see what the result is? It says here at the end, verse 14, I love this little sentence. For the glory, the cloud comes and it says, for the glory of the Lord filled the temple of God. Where else would the glory of the Lord go but the temple of God? For the glory of the Lord filled the temple of God. And what I want to finish with is just, I suppose, to make the point that for some of us, we actually doubt the fact that God wants to make his home in us. And so we hear this stuff about sacrifice and song and priority and pleasure, and we, yeah, okay. But really our mindset is it's like an earning one, and I know that because that's me. So much of the time I've got to earn him. You know, and we have, for whatever reason, some sort of block to believing that he wants to be at home in us. That he wants to be at home. Have you seen my life? Have you seen the things I think? Have you seen the things I've done? We disqualify ourselves. I get it for that person and sure for him over there, but for me, no. And we have this weird thing where we disqualify not just ourselves and our own lives, but our churches and our communities as well. Oh, the Holy Spirit can be in this place because he likes warehouses, but not my place. The Holy Spirit can be in a place of worship where it's on a screen, but if you get a book out, I'm not sure you can follow along, so he doesn't seem to show up. And we disqualify the places that we come from experiencing and knowing the manifest presence of God. We have this block there. And the point I just want to finish with is the glory of the Lord fills the temple of God. We're the temple. The church is the temple. Doesn't matter what tradition, doesn't matter what style of worship, doesn't matter whether it feels like it's alive or it feels like it's dead. The church is the temple of God. And what the glory of God does is it fills the temple of God. It comes to his home, his temple, his place, his people. And if we doubt that, the place we need to come back to is this book again. We just need to have a little look at this book again and see some of the stuff it says. I finish with this. Imagine you and I were a few things. Imagine you and I are watching Usain Bolt run the 100 meters in the last Olympics. And we know he wins gold. We're there, we're watching it, he wins gold. And then you turn to me, you say, I'm not sure Usain Bolt really wanted that. I'm not sure he really was hungry for it. Now, what would I do if that's what you said? I'd say, you're crazy, man. No one wins 100 meters in the Olympics, not least three times in a row, without having, like, he might, you know, act like he's laid back, but inside there is this burning desire to win, you know? And then I'd say, why don't we just watch the replay? Let's just watch the replay. Let's slow it down. And we'd slow it down and we'd watch Bolt run the 100 meters all over again. And we would see, as we watched it, his eyes popping and the sweat pouring off him and the legs kind of pumping. And we'd see that at the end of that race, yes, he does the kind of the Usain Bolt thing, but also we'd see his hands on knees panting because what he's just done is spent himself in order to win. And in the scripture, what we see is that God spends himself in order to win us. And sure, Bolt makes it look inevitable, and so does God, in the sense of he's always going to get there. He's always going to win. But we look at the Son of God. We look at the way that he comes to be among us, Emmanuel, God with us. And then we look at the life that he lived and the death that he died, and we see the blood and the sweat and the tears of Christ. We look at the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, our Savior, and you see that, and you think, wow, he had to want what he was pursuing. He was trying to win, or at least he did win you. He did win me. He wants to be with us. If he gave his only son for us, will he not along with him also give us all things? If you were to look at my bank balance, if you had access to it, which thank goodness you don't, but you would see that Beth and I, you go through our kind of like our online accounts, and you see that in our Flex account, we have a certain amount of money, not particularly a lot of money, but it's in there. You'd see that we have a savings account, we have a small amount of savings, and you would also see that we have a mortgage. We have a mortgage that is 35 years long, because that's the only way we could afford to buy a house in Watford. We own a terrace house, we're in the process of moving, but we own a small terrace house in Watford that is worth £1.7 million. That's a joke. It's just property prices. It will be very soon. But anyway, we own this house, right? And let's say that you look at that and you understand just by a glance at my finances that what we're doing there is we have a little bit of money, but we've got this huge amount of money that we're paying off. And the reason that we're paying it off is because that's the only way we could afford to buy a house. And we've promised not just our present income, but the future income that we'll have for the next 35 years is going to be paying off this house. You would assume, having looked at that, and what we're spending and how we've decided to arrange our finances that we can afford that we would want to live in that place, wouldn't you? Look at the way that he lives. Look at the gospel. Look at what it costs him. Look at the way that he gives up his only son for us. Like, surely if you saw that, you would assume that he would want to live in the place that he buys with his blood, that he'd want to live in the place that he wins with his death, that he would want to live in you, that he would want to live in me, that he would want to live in your church, that he would want to live in your small group. The vision of Jesus for the church of Jesus Christ is that we would be a people, a body, a family, a home that is full of his manifest presence. We don't have to twist his arm. We don't need to beg. All we need to do is be willing to show him that we want the same thing. And the way that we do that is we sacrifice and we sing. We prioritize and we take pleasure in the manifest presence of the living God.